Hello, Mark Pearson, Executive and Artistic Director of the College Light Opera Company, coming to you from one of the most stunning places in Falmouth, Highfield Hall. I'm in the ballroom, formerly the receiving rooms of the Beebe family. Highfield Hall will be reopening for visitors in July. Welcome to the first of our 9 online lectures in our series, Highfield on the CLOC. This lecture series is made possible through our partnership with Highfield Hall, as well as a grant from the Woods Hole Foundation. Our guest today is Professor Beth Burrier, a longtime CLOC music director and our associate artistic director. Beth's topic today is women in theater. I hope you enjoy the lecture.
Hi, I'm Beth Burrier, the associate artistic director and one of the principal conductors of the College Light Opera Company. Thank you so much for joining me for our first On the CLOC of the 2020 season. Today, we're going to talk about women in theater. Truth in advertising. We're going to talk about women in American theater, leaning towards women who work in musical theater, because that's my area of expertise. Now, I apologize in advance if I've left out anyone that you think is important. We're going to look at about 40 or 45 women who have made great contributions to the art of theater in America. And I know there are at least that many more that I could have talked about. But I hope you'll find something interesting in this talk, a new person, a new fact, something that you'll get interested in and maybe do some more research, because we're going to move pretty fast and hit some highlights. So here we go. The pioneers. Dorothy Donnelly, working at a time when theater as we know it was really being born. She was an actress, a playwright, a librettist, meaning she writes the scenes for musicals or operettas, a producer, and a director. She started as an actress, including in the title role of Candida, and she made the play Madam X on Broadway, very famous, and was also in the 1916 silent film. But the reason we really remember Dorothy Donnelly today is for her work as a librettist. First, on the 1921 musical Blossom Time, which is a fictionalized biography of German composer Franz Schubert, but even more importantly, for 1924's The Student Prince, CLOC favorite operetta by Sigmund Romberg, which went on to be the longest-running show of the 1920s, which is saying something, considering that Showboat and Good News and Of the I Sing were all also enormous hits at that time. But Dorothy Donnelly and Sigmund Romberg's hit operetta was the longest-running show of the 1920s. Another Dorothy Fields, also a librettist and a lyricist. She wrote more than 400 songs for 15 Broadway musicals and 26 films. Some of her most famous songs include The Way You Look Tonight, A Fine Romance, On the Sunny Side of the Street, Pick Yourself Up, I'm in the Mood for Love, and Big Spender. She worked with composers from Jerome Kern and Irving Berlin and Cy Coleman, along with many others. She first worked with Jerome Kern on the movie version of Roberta and also on the movie Swing Time, which earned them Academy Award for the song The Way You Look Tonight. It was Dorothy Fields who took the idea for a musical based on the life of sharpshooter Annie Oakley to Oscar Hammerstein too, in hopes that he would produce the show, which he agreed to do, hiring Dorothy Fields and Jerome Kern to write the book and the music. When Kern died unexpectedly, Irving Berlin was brought in to compose. Dorothy Fields and her brother, Herbert, wrote the book and the musical Annie Get Your Gun, starring Ethel Merman, who we'll talk about a little bit later, was born. She went on, Ms. Fields went on to work on the shows Redhead, Sweet Charity, and Seesaw. She was inducted into the American Theater Hall of Fame in 1988. Betty Comden, part of the writing team and performing team of Comden and Green, with her partner, her professional partner, they weren't married, Adolph Green. They wrote such indelible hits as Singin' in the Rain, I know, a movie first, but I have to mention it, and the two Bernstein shows, On the Town, for which they also wrote themselves roles, and Wonderful Town. I'll let Betty Comden tell you about her work.
Fizzy, light, frothy. You know, I mean, I know that's what you say, but we have written songs like Some Other Time, mm-hmm. yes. and Lonely Town. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a deep thread of real feeling in what we do. I think comedy is very hard to do.
Indeed.
And that back of what we do, I think, is a real feeling for human values and a dislike for any kind of pretense. And so I don't think they're that inconsequential.
No, I would.
That's what I say.
So, from Betty Comden herself on the importance of their work, they also wrote Bells Are Ringing. They translated and streamlined Die Fledermaus for the Metropolitan Opera. They wrote the screenplay for Auntie Mame and lyrics for Do Re Mi, as well as books. Lyrics for Do Re Mi, Subways Are Sleeping, Fade Out, Fade In, Hallelujah Baby, Applause, On the 20th Century, and their final musical, The Will Rogers Follies. Comden and Green received Kennedy Center honors in 1991. Lucy, Lady Duff Gordon. Her fashion house was named Lucille, and in addition to her work in high fashion, she also was a costumer for Broadway. Her contributions included redesigning women's undergarments of the time in order to provide more freedom of movement and just more ease in daily life. She also invented what we know now as the fashion show, with runway models modeling the clothes. For Broadway, she designed the 1907 production of The Merry Widow, as well as several of the Ziegfeld Follies reviews from 1915 to 1921. And here's a look at her costumes for one of those Ziegfeld Follies. The Ziegfeld Follies were so famous for their lavish costuming and the big showgirl hats and whatnot, and Lucy Lady Duff Gordon was instrumental in those designs. Another costumer, Irene Sheriff. You know her work, I'm sure, from both the Broadway and the movie productions of The King and I and West Side Story. But in addition to those, she also designed for Lady in the Dark, As Thousands Cheer, A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, Flower Drum Song, and Jerome Robbins Broadway. She also worked in the ballet world and the dance world for American Ballet Theater, New York City Ballet, the Ballet Russe de Monte Carlo, and designed costumes for movies including Meet Me in St. Louis, Hello, Dolly, Guys and Dolls, An American in Paris, Funny Girl, and Porgy and Bess. The Irene Sheriff Lifetime Achievement Award was inaugurated in 1993, and she was the first recipient. And the award is now bestowed annually to a costume designer who, over the course of their career, has achieved great distinction and mastery of the art in theater, film, opera, or dance. Jean Rosenthal, a lighting designer. She's considered the pioneer in the field of theatrical lighting design. And when she started her career, lighting designer was not a formalized position. The set designer and an electrician would light the set. But Rosenthal helped to make the lighting designer an integral part of the design team and said that lighting was a career in and of itself. Some of her major contributions were the elimination of shadows by using floodlights from upstage behind the actors and controlling the angles of light in order to get the shadows and the look that you want, things we just take for granted today. She also was active in lighting dance, especially using diagonal shafts of light for Martha Graham. And here's a not terrific quality, but you get the idea of some of her work with the shaft of light and the controlled shadow. Agnes DeMille, choreographer. When she choreographed Aaron Copland's ballet Rodeo, it was such a success that she was approached to choreograph for Oklahoma, creating the famous Dream Ballet that led to the beginning of the golden age of music theater, where dance, singing, and the plot all worked together to help tell the story. When the actors in the original cast of Oklahoma saw the Dream Ballet for the first time, they stood and applauded and said that if their work was half as clear as hers in telling the story of the show would be a huge success. After Oklahoma, Agnes DeMille went on to choreograph Bloomer Girl, Carousel, Allegro, Brigadoon, for which she was co-recipient of the very first Tony Award for Best Choreography, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Paint Your Wagon, and 110 in the Shade. We'll take just a little look at some of her work with the original cast of Carousel. This is the original cast and her choreography. Could watch that choreography all day, but we should move on to our first woman in theater who is a famous actress. Now, as I chose actresses for this talk, I tried to choose women who were pioneering in some way or who inspired creative teams to write for them. And our first actress is Fanny Brice, who was, of course, very famous in the Ziegfeld Follies as a singer and as a comedian, her signature song, My Man, and as well as, of course, Secondhand Rose, which she introduced to the Follies in 1921. So a huge Broadway and theater star before she went on into radio with Baby Snooks. She is a posthumous recipient of a Grammy Hall of Fame Award for the 1921 recording of My Man. Her other Broadway credits besides Ziegfeld included Fioretta, Sweet and Low, Billy Rose's Crazy Quilt. As promised, Ethel Merman. Now, we all know about the voice and the belting and her brash personality, but Ethel Merman made it okay for, along with Fanny Brice, for a strong, smart woman to be the lead in a show. The original Reno Sweeney in Anything Goes, Annie Oakley in Annie Get Your Gun, and of course, in the original cast of Girl Crazy, which became Crazy for You, singing I Got Rhythm. We'll take a look at her singing arguably her signature song, There's No Business Like Show Business.
Like show business, like no business I know. Everything about it is appealing. Everything the traffic will allow. Nowhere could you get that happy feeling when you are stealing that extra bow. There's no people like show people. They smile when they are low. Yesterday they told you you would not go far. You open, and there you are. Next day on your dressing room, they've hung a star. Let's go on with us.
Ah, Ethel. And of course, after Annie Get Your Gun, she went on to do Call Me Madam, Happy Hunting, and Gypsy. Ethel Merman, a real pioneer. Another lighting designer, Theron Musser. As you can see there, she lighted Long Day's Journey and Tonight, the musical Follies, Chorus Line, Dream Girls, all three of which she won Tony Awards for, Applause, A Little Night Music, Pacific Overtures, and 42nd Street. She is termed the Dean of American Lighting Designers and is yet another pioneer in her field, along with Gene Rosenthal. Her work on A Chorus Line, and we have a picture here, the upper left-hand picture is A Chorus Line, and then Dream Girls there. A Chorus Line was the first Broadway musical to use a computerized light board, which is, of course, now the industry standard. Up until that time, they used manually operated piano boards where each light was on an individual dimmer. It was very complicated to get lights to do anything at all with those boards. And, of course, if you know A Chorus Line, the lighting is so integral to telling that story as we transition in and out of the dancers' imaginations and we're crossing time and all sorts of things are happening. And the lighting helps us to understand what's happening. And Theron Musser, huge pioneer in that part of the field. Our first woman composer, Mary Rogers. Here she is with her famous father, Richard Rogers. Her first full-length musical was Once Upon a Mattress, which starred Carol Burnett. And she also wrote for The Mad Show, which was a musical review based on Mad Magazine. She did some other songs here and there, but really, at one point in her life, just stopped playing the piano. She said, I'm not my father, I'm not my son. Her son is Adam Gittle, composer of the musicals Floyd Collins, Myths and Hymns, and The Light in the Piazza. And she said, no, I'm not my father, I'm not my son, so I'm just going to stop, which is kind of sad, actually very sad. She also wrote the book, literally the children's book, Freaky Friday, which was turned into a film. And she wrote other children's books as well. But our first female composer, most well known for Once Upon a Mattress. Anna White, choreographer and performer. She started as a dancer in Finian's Rainbow in 1947, but then went on to become a choreographer for musicals such as Carmen Jones, Irma LaDuce, Mame, 70 Girls 70, Gigi, Working, and movies such as Oliver. She won a Special Academy Award for Furthering Dance in Film for the movie Oliver. And as you might have guessed here, she also was the original choreographer for both the Broadway and the movie of The Music Man. And we'll just take a quick look at Mary and the Librarian from Music Man. She also was very skilled at telling story through dance.
Madam Librarian, read. Oh, what can I say, my dear, to make it clear? I need you badly, badly, Madam Librarian, Marion. If I stumbled and I busted my whatchamacallit, I could lie on your floor unnoticed till my body had turned to carrion. Madam Librarian. Now in the moonlight.
So Anna White and Music Man, along with others. Margot Lyon was a producer. She died in January of this year. And so a producer is the person who gathers money, hires the creative team, has a say in casting, is really sort of the power behind the throne, if you will, for a Broadway show or for any show. And she produced many plays, including Frankie and Johnny in the Clair de Lune. And her first Broadway show was I Hate Hamlet in 1991. In 93 and 94, she produced Angels in America, Millennium Approaches, and Perestroika, along with the 1995 production of Seven Guitars. She also produced Hairspray, the hit Broadway show, Tony Award-winning show, Caroliner Change, The Wedding Singer, Radio Golf, and she won a Tony Award for Elaine Stritch at Liberty. She also was the producer of Catch Me If You Can, which opened in 2009. So Margot Lyon, very successful producer of plays and musicals. Susan H. Shulman, a director, our first female director. For a while, she was the president of the Society of Stage Directors and Choreographers on the Tony nominating committee, had several Broadway shows, including the first revival of Sweeney Todd, The Secret Garden, Little Women, her version of Merrily We Roll Along, one of Sondheim's more troubled works in terms of its structure. It starts at the end and works its way back to the beginning. And for a long while, Susan was her version of it was the version that Sondheim liked the best. Her work on Secret Garden, she worked with Lucy Simon and Marcia Norman, Lucy Simon the composer, Marcia Norman book and lyrics, and the set designer, Heidi Ettinger, to bring this lavish children's book to life. And we'll have a look at the Tony Award performance of The Secret Garden. And yes, that is Julie Andrews.
Westenberg and Mandy Patinkin.
The Secret Garden begins as the newly orphaned Mary Lennox arrives at her Uncle Archibald's gloomy Yorkshire manor.
So there's just a little look at the work of Heidi Ettinger, Marcia Norman, Lucy Simon, and Susan H. Shulman. Heidi Ettinger, the set designer for Secret Garden, also was the first woman to win a Tony Award for set design, and she won that for the musical Big River. And she also designed sets for The Triumph of Love and The Sound of Music revival in 1997. And the New York Times wrote of her, if there is an Ettinger trademark linking all of her designs, it's that there is no trademark because she never does the same thing twice. Graziella Danielle, another director. She started as a performer and choreographer and then went on and her first choreography work on Broadway was for the 1981 version of The Pirates of Penzance. She also choreographed Zorba, The Rink, The Mystery of Edwin Drood, Once on This Island, The Goodbye Girl, the original production of Ragtime, and then the 1990 revival of Annie Get Your Gun. She became the director and the choreographer for that, for Marie Christine, for The Pirate Queen, for which she provided musical staging, and then in 2015, The Visit. So a very prolific director and choreographer, Graziella Danielle. Paula Vogel is a playwright. She won the 1998 Pulitzer Prize for Drama for How I Learned to Drive. She's also been a teacher, mostly at Brown University in Rhode Island, and she's also been the playwright in residence at the Yale Repertory Theater. Along with her other most famous work, along with How I Learned to Drive, is Indecent, which was nominated for a Tony Award in 2017. Other shows include Apple Brown Betty, The Baltimore Waltz, The Long Christmas Ride Home, and A Civil War Christmas. Julie Andrews. Now here is a woman who needs no introduction in so many movies, in so many musicals. The original Liza Doolittle in My Fair Lady, Camelot, and Guinevere in Camelot was written for her. Of course, the movies Mary Poppins. So truly a woman who who has inspired so many people in so many ways. Gwen Verdon. Gwen Verdon, if you have not watched the Fox series Fosse Verdon, you might want to look at that. I think it's really terrific, and it gives you a really good look into the inner workings of their relationship and at Gwen Verdon's career. She helped Bob Fosse so much to define his style and to work through his personal demons and to bring his artistic vision to life. And she was a huge star of such shows as Sweet Charity, Pajama Game, Damn Yankees, Chicago. Really an inspiration to so many people. Her first show was Can Can, the Cole Porter musical, Can Can. And we'll take just a quick look at Gwen Verdon in the movie of Damn Yankees, Whatever Lola Wants.
Well, we have to keep training and strict rules and all that.
You can tell me all their rules.
You're making things very complicated.
Then be good boy.
I'm trying to.
And do like Lola tells you to do. Whatever Lola wants, Lola gets. And little man, little Lola wants you. Make up your mind to have no regrets. Recline yourself, resign yourself, you're through. I always get what I aim for, and your heart and soul is what I came for. Whatever Lola wants, Lola gets. No use to fight, don't you know you can't win? You're no exception to the rule. I'm irresistible, you fool. Give in.
Just a little taste of Gwen Verdon. Diane Paulus, a director of many, many shows, including Finding Neverland on Broadway, the musical, Witness Uganda, a play depicting an American aid worker in Uganda coming to terms with the realities of the situation on the ground. A revival of Pippin in 2013 that was nominated for 10 Tony Awards, including the award for Best Revival of a Musical. Also changing the gender of the original leading player, which was Ben Vereen, into a female leading player. Her very controversial version of Porgy and Bess, which changed multiple things about the show, including taking out the goat and the goat cart for Porgy. Waitress, which just closed on Broadway and was the first Broadway musical with an all-female creative team, nominated for 4 Tony Awards. And just this season, she directed Jagged Little Pill, which opened in the fall and was looking to be a hot contender in the 2020 Tony race, until we had to take a little intermission, just for now. So Diane Paulus, director. Tina Landau, another director of site-specific productions. So where you take a show and you craft it so that it works in a specific site that isn't necessarily a theater. Her first musical was off-Broadway, Adam Gittle's Floyd Collins, and she was nominated for a Drama Desk Award for that. She then directed the 2001 revival of Bells Are Ringing with Faith Prince, and in 2015 directed SpongeBob SquarePants, the Broadway musical. She also directed Paula Vogel's A Civil War Christmas at the New York Theater Workshop, and she also wrote the book for Floyd Collins. And she's also written book and lyrics for Dream True and States of Independence, both new musicals with scores by Ricky Ian Gordon. So Tina Landau. Susan Stroman, also known as Stro, she started as a performer, and her big break as a choreographer came in 1987 with the off-Broadway revival of Flora the Red Menace, a Candor and Ebb musical that had originally starred Liza Minnelli. And after working with Candor and Ebb, she worked with them to create a review of their work called And the World Goes Round in 1992. She then was the director and choreographer for Crazy for You, which won the Tony Award for Best Musical and her first Tony Award for Best Choreography. Her second Tony Award came when she won when she worked with Hal Prince on the revival of Showboat and choreographed that with lots of innovative ideas, including showing how the Charleston came from African-American people and was appropriated to become the social dance hit that we all know. She directed the musical Big, the revival of Oklahoma in 1999, Steel Pier, another Candor and Ebb show. Her first Broadway show as a director was actually The Music Man, in 2000, and which then led her to choreograph Contact, the dance play, which won Tony for Best Musical. Then, of course, she went on to do The Producers, Young Frankenstein, and Scottsboro Boys, the last of the Candor and Ebb shows. We'll take a quick look at Crazy for You. This is from the Tony Award performance in 1992.
Now that's enough. That's enough. The opening set for the first of tonight's four Tony-nominated musicals, Crazy for You.
Bad news, go away, all round, someday, in March or May. I can't be bothered now. My bonds and shares may fall downstairs. Who cares? Who cares? I'm dancing and I can't be bothered now.
Hi, Bobby.
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 A little taste of Susan Stroman's choreography. I'm not sure that I said this right. She was the choreographer for Crazy for You, and she met the man who became her husband, Mike Ockrent, who was the director of Crazy for You. So Stro choreographing Crazy for You in 1992, and her first Broadway work as a director and choreographer in 2000 for the revival of Music Man. And next, we have yet another director. Yes, Julie Taymor of The Lion King. Her work with puppetry and costumes and how she translated The Lion King from the screen to the stage in a way that evoked the movie but was also so specific to the live theater. Just amazing work. She went on to do Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark, slightly controversial work, not quite as well received as The Lion King, but no conversation about women in theater can be complete without Julie Taymor. Kathleen Marshall, another director choreographer. Her first credits were for the choreography of the 1997 revival of 1776, Kiss Me Kate in 1999, and in 2003 she became a director choreographer with the revival of Wonderful Town. She went on to do The Pajama Game, Anything Goes in 2011, Nice Work If You Can Get It in 2012, and in 2016, In Transit, a very small musical that was all a cappella in Circle in the Square. So Kathleen Marshall. Rachel Shapkin, who is a director, and she has worked off-Broadway on shows like Three Pianos, but her work that is most well-known is her work with Dave Malloy on Natasha, Pierre, and the Great Comet of 1812, which opened off-Broadway and had such a huge critical success and commercial success that it was then transferred to Broadway, and an entire theater was gutted in order to maintain the intimacy of the off-Broadway production. She then directed the folk opera Hadestown, written by Anais Mitchell, which won the Tony for Best Musical in 2019. She also just directed another Dave Malloy work, Moby Dick, at the American Repertory Theater at Harvard in 2019. Lynn Ahrens, one half of the composing and lyricist team Flaherty and Ahrens. She is a composer and a lyricist. You probably all know her work from Schoolhouse Rock, as well as her theatrical work. Schoolhouse Rock, the Saturday morning cartoon series, educational cartoon series from the 70s that talked about everything from math to government to history and everything in between. Her list of Broadway credits is nothing short of astonishing, starting with Lucky Stiff in 1988, Once on This Island, My Favorite Year, A Christmas Carol, which also became a TV film, Ragtime, Seussical, A Man of No Importance, Dessa Rose, The Glorious Ones, Rocky, the musical, Little Dancer, and Anastasia. So much work there between Stephen Flaherty and Lynn Ahrens that has just changed the face of American music theater in its treatment of stories of people of color, of women, just an amazing catalog of work. Janine Tesori. She started as an arranger of dance music for the revival of How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying in 1995. And in 1997, her off-Broadway musical, Violet, won an Obie Award and the New York Drama Critics Circle Award for Best Musical, along with the Lucille Lortel Award for Outstanding Musical. Violet was also directed by Susan H. Shulman. She served as an associate conductor for The Secret Garden and The Who's Tommy. And in 2000, she and Dick Scanlon, the lyricist, wrote songs for a stage adaptation of Thoroughly Modern Millie, which became a breakout hit show. And she was nominated for the Tony Award for Best Original Score and the Drama Desk Award for Outstanding Music. She went on to write musicals, including Shrek the Musical, Fun Home, Carolina Change, and I know I'm forgetting one. There's one other one. And she's also written music for plays, including, and films, including Knights in Rodanthe, The Loss of a Teardrop Diamond, The Little Mermaid, Ariel's Beginning, Shrek the Third, The Emperor's New Groove 2, and on and on. She's also now writing operas, including The Lion, the Unicorn, and Me, which had its premiere at the Washington National Opera in 2013. And here's her new musical, Soft Power, which is named as a Pulitzer Prize for Drama finalist in 2020. So Janine Tesori, and we are going to look at one song from Fun Home. This is Ring of Keys.
You didn't notice her at first, Dad, but I did. I saw her the minute she walked in. I'd never seen a woman who looked like her. It was like I was a traveler in a foreign country who runs into someone from home. Someone they've never met before, but somehow just recognizes.
Someone just came in the door, like no one I ever saw before. I feel you. I don't know where you came from. I wish I did. I feel so dumb. I feel your swagger and your bearing and the just right clothes you're wearing, your short hair and your dungarees and your lace-up boots and your keys. Oh, your ring of keys.
It's just a snippet from Janine Tesori. And now we have Georgia Stitt, who has a CLOC connection. She spent at least one summer in the College Light Opera Company. And she's a pianist, a conductor, and a music director. She's worked on Little Shop of Horrors, Avenue Q, Sweet Smell of Success, The Music Man, Titanic, Annie, and the national tour of Parade. She has composed musicals including Big Red Sun, Sing Me a Happy Song, and Hello, My Baby. But her newest venture is something called Maestra. And this is an organization for women in theater, in women musicians in theater. And this has become, she started this maybe a year ago, and it has become such a source of support and community and for women helping women, and is just a really great thing. And if someone is looking to hire a female music director or arranger or a music assistant or a dance arranger or whatever it is, they can go to Maestra and see people's resumes. It's sort of a giant LinkedIn for female theatrical musicians, all from the mind of Georgia Stitt. Kim Grigsby, another music director. She was maybe not the first famous female music or the first female music director, but she was the first one that I was ever aware of with her work on Full Monty. But in addition to music directing on Broadway, she also, Full Monty, she did You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, Carolina Change, Spring Awakening, Grease, Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark, Amelie, Head Over Heels, To Kill a Mockingbird, a play with the play, the music for the play, and To Kill a Mockingbird. And she was supposed to be opening Flying Sunset this spring. So Kim Grigsby, music director, done a lot of work. Andrea Grody, another CLOC connection. She was an associate conductor in the summer of 2011 and has gone on to be the music director and did a lot of the vocal arranging for the Tony Award-winning musical The Band's Visit, and was also a music director for David Yazbek's show Tootsie. David Yazbek also wrote The Band's Visit. Opened last year. Tootsie opened last year. And we'll take a quick look at the trailer, the teaser trailer for The Band's Visit.
General, you can stay here with us tonight if you want.
No, no. You have done too much already.
Okay. Long ago, a group of musicians came to Israel from Egypt. You probably didn't hear about it. It wasn't very important.
There's a little bit of Andrea Grody's work there. And another CLOC alum, Mary Mitchell Campbell. She is a conductor, music director, orchestrator, composer, and arranger. Has served as music director for so many Broadway shows. I'll give you a very short list. Mean Girls, The Prom, Tuck Everlasting, Finding Neverland, Big Fish. I could go on, but I will stop there. She's very passionate about arts education and poverty reduction and is the founder and co-executive director of A Step, Artists Striving to End Poverty, which recruits and trains high-level artists to work with kids in extreme situations to help teach them health education and life skills through the arts. So a real leader in the arts and how arts can touch the larger community, Mary Mitchell Campbell. Jennifer Ashley Tepper is on everybody's top 10 list of people to watch in theater. She does it all. She has produced the musicals Be More Chill, Broadway Bounty Hunter, and Love and Hate Nation. She is the creative and programming director at Feinstein's 54 Below and is the author of a whole series of books, The Untold Stories of Broadway. She's the creator of the Jonathan Larson Project and is the historian consultant for the upcoming film version of Tick, Tick, Boom, Jonathan Larson's less well-known musical, After Rent. So she just does it all and is just such a force in New York and in regionally as she is producing and writing and just doing all kinds of really neat work. So Jennifer Ashley Tepper. Stacey Mindich is another producer, including, and her shows have included Hedwig and the Angry Inch, Bridges of Madison County. She was one of the producers on Catch Me If You Can, along with Margot Lyon. And her most famous show, Dear Evan Hansen. So she's produced a lot of theater. Paloma Young is a costume designer, and she won the Tony Award for Best Costume Design for a Play for her work on Peter and the Starcatcher. And she was nominated for Natasha Pierre and the Great Comet of 1812. And here's some of her work, some of her renderings for the costumes in Natasha Pierre. And another lighting designer, Natasha Katz, she was nominated in 2017 for Hello Dolly, for a Tony, and for an Olivier, which is the British version of the Tonys, for The Glass Menagerie. She won the 2016 Tony for Best Lighting Design of a Play, for Long Day's Journey and Tonight. She has more than 60 Broadway credits. Here's the short, quick list. Frozen, Cats, School of Rock, Gigi, An American in Paris, for which she won a Tony Award, Aladdin, Motown, Once, for which she won a 2012 Tony Award, The Coast of Utopia, Salvage, 2007 Tony Award, a revival of A Chorus Line, The Sweet Smell of Success, Aida, for which she won the 2000 Tony Award. The list goes on. And here's a look at her work in Frozen and Hello, Dolly. Sarah DeLapp is a playwright. She wrote The Wolves, which has become a very famous play. This was in 2016. It premiered off-Broadway. And it centers on the experiences of high school girls through their weekly Saturday morning pregame soccer warm-ups. The play was a finalist for the 2017 Pulitzer Prize for Drama and has been produced across the country. This is an up-and-coming playwright to watch. Danai Gurira, you may recognize her for her, because she's a movie actress in the Avengers movies, among other things, Avengers Infinity War, Black Panther. She was also in The Walking Dead. But she's a Broadway playwright, and she wrote Eclipsed, and she was nominated for a Tony for Best Play, and continues to write, and it will be interesting to see what happens next for her as a playwright. Chiara Alegria Hudis is also a playwright, a lyricist, and an essayist. She's best known for writing the book to Lin-Manuel Miranda's musical In the Heights. She also wrote a play entitled Elliot, A Soldier's Fugue, which was a finalist for the 2007 Pulitzer Prize for Drama. And she won the 2012 Pulitzer Prize for Drama for her play Water by the Spoonful. Lynn Nottage is a playwright and screenwriter, and she is the first and the only woman to have won 2 Pulitzer Prizes for drama. She won one for Ruined and another for Sweat, and her other, which are both plays, and other works include writing the book for the upcoming musical MJ, which is features the music of Michael Jackson. It was supposed to open this July, but has been postponed for a little bit. And other plays include Malema's Tale, By the Way, and Intimate Apparel. So Lynn Nottage, the only woman to win 2 Pulitzer Prizes for drama. Dominique Morisseau, playwright, has written so many plays, including Blood at the Root, Pipeline, which won the Edgerton Foundation New Play Award in 2016, Mudrow, The Confederates, and one more, Detroit 67. So a very prolific playwright. Pipeline was just streamed this past weekend, which was the third weekend in May, and premiered at Lincoln Center Theater. So a terrific playwright, up and coming. Hopefully another show on Broadway for her. Ah, more actresses. So the list here could go on and on. Bernadette Peters, who has inspired Stephen Sondheim, among others. Kelly O'Hara, Kristen Chenoweth. As I said, the list could go on and on. But I've chosen Patti LuPone, very outspoken artist. You may have seen some of her basement filming when Rosie O'Donnell did her coronavirus benefit with all of these Broadway actors. We saw into the inner workings of Patti LuPone's basement, and it was so charming that she went on and did a few more videos from her basement. Very outspoken, is about to be in the revival of Company, was the original Eva Perón in Evita, and we are going to look at her work in Les Mis. Patti LuPone. Sutton Foster. For a while, it felt like every Broadway show that opened had to have Sutton Foster in it. It's not a bad thing. She was the original Millie in Thoroughly Modern Millie. She was in The Drowsy Chaperone. She was in Young Frankenstein. So many things. Another Reno Sweeney in Anything Goes. And, of course, is cast opposite Hugh Jackman in the upcoming revival of The Music Man, which we, fingers crossed, hope that we will see at some point. So a real powerhouse on Broadway, and of course has moved on and is also doing television and films. And our last woman in theater for today, Audra McDonald, winner of so many Tony Awards, was in Carousel, Ragtime, 110 in the Shade, Marie Christine, on and on. A beautiful voice, beautiful actress, such a talent, such a light. And I want to leave you with the entire duet from Ragtime with her original co-star, Brian Stokes Mitchell, Wheels of a Dream. Thank you so much for joining me and watching this. And I hope that you will take advantage of all of the CLOC programming for our digital season 2020. Stay safe.
I see his face. I hear his heartbeat. I look in those eyes. How wise they seem. Well, when he is old enough, I will show him America, and he will ride on the wheels of a dream. We'll go down south. Turning for us, girl, and the times are starting to roll. Any man can get where he wants to if he's got some fire in his soul. We'll see justice, Sarah, and plenty of men who will stand up and give us our due. Oh, Sarah, it's more than promises. Sarah, it must be true.
This lecture was part of our larger program, Digital CLOC. Digital CLOC is made possible by a generous gift by Phil and Liz Gross. If you'd like to learn more about our programming or find out how you can become a supporter, please visit collegelightoperacompany.com. Join us next week as CLOC alum Professor Jacob Allen talks about My Fair Lady, the musical that almost never happened. If you'd like to join Jacob in a free post-lecture discussion, you can register by visiting highfieldhallandgardens.org and clicking on Highfield on the CLOC. Hope to see you there.